Hello, and welcome to the first episode of Expected Value, a podcast that goes inside the sports analytics world. I'm Paul Carr from True Media Networks, and our goals for this podcast are to pull back the curtain a bit, to talk with people in the sports industry about what they do, how they use analytics, and how they got to where they are. So if you like sports and/or analytics, I think you'll find something to like here. Our first guest is the Minnesota Twins' Daniel Adler, who has a fascinating career path that began with Major League Baseball, moved to the NFL, working with the Patriots and Browns until 2012, when the Jacksonville Jaguars hired him to launch their football research and development group, one of the first such groups in the league. After years in football, Adler's now been with the Twins for nearly 2 years as their Director of Baseball Operations. In my conversation with Adler, he'll tell us what a Director of Baseball Operations does and how he uses analytics, how he and his team communicate with on-field personnel, what's going on with the Twins' home run explosion this season, differences between baseball and football analytics, what he looks for in potential employees, and he even caps things off with a Bartolo Colon story. Then Albert Larcata and I will be back to react to the interview and wrap things up. Now, without further ado, here's the Expected Value conversation with the Minnesota Twins' Daniel Adler. We're joined on Expected Value by Daniel Adler, the Minnesota Twins Director of Baseball Operations. Daniel, thank you for joining us. Let's start at a high level with just something that may not be known by people who haven't worked with a team. I know I didn't really know until the last couple of years working more closely with baseball teams. Tell us, just broadly speaking, what do you do? What are the areas of responsibility for you and the baseball operations department?
Good question. And I think even if you have worked with a baseball team, the role of Director of Baseball Ops can vary a lot from team to team. It can pretty much mean just about anything. So for me with the Twins, my primary responsibility is overseeing our research and development group. We have a team of analysts and a team of developers. And really, I try to just get out of the way and let their great ideas flourish and impact our decision making. I also do some work in terms of transactions, some smaller transactions when we send players to Asia. I keep some weird hours, so I tend to be the person who makes those phone calls with Japan or Korea. I also do some work on the arbitration side of things, whether it's the negotiation part on the front end or if we're unsuccessful in negotiation, some work preparing our case, which thankfully, we've only gone one time in the past, I think more than a dozen years. We didn't go this past year, but we did go my first year with the team. So I'd say those are the primary areas of responsibility, but I've really had a chance to dabble in a lot of different areas. One great thing about the research and development group is we get to really touch all parts of baseball operations. So player development, amateur scouting, pro scouting, and even a fair amount on the health and performance side.
That's a lot of stuff. Tell me, what's a normal day like for you, we'll say during the regular season? You know, so just a normal, you know, Tuesday or whatever it might be.
A normal Tuesday. So today, I guess it's a pretty normal Tuesday. So I would say probably roughly a quarter of my time in any given week is spent kind of meeting individual analysts and developers one-on-one, just checking in, making sure they have everything they need, getting status updates on an individual level. We also, a couple times a week, we get together and we have a scrum where each person gives a rapid fire update of what they're working on, where they're blocked, where they maybe need some help. That's usually followed by a little presentation from somebody on their group, can be an analyst or it can be a developer, where they show off something they've worked on and try to get feedback. Today, I also had a Spanish class over the lunch period, and then some meetings with some people from the business side of the organization, and giving where we share updates on what each respective department is doing. So I would say this is a reasonably average day. And then occasionally I get some time to sit down and do a little bit of analysis myself, where I'll dig into either True Media or some of our internal tables and try to answer some questions. But I would say I rank very low on our list of analysts, and I spend a lot more of our time really just making sure our analysts have the right resources that they need.
So what sort of interactions on kind of a daily basis do you or members of your team have with, you know, coaching staffs or players, the on-field personnel?
I guess there are two different types of on-field personnel broadly. There's our minor league on-field personnel and our major league personnel. We're really fortunate that we get to spend a lot of time with the major league group because they're here half of the time during the season. And so we have a couple analysts who are really fully dedicated to the major league staff, answering their questions, doing a lot of advanced research. I think that role of advanced scout, which historically was actually somebody who would go out in advance of the team and go see people ahead of time, has now become a little bit more of a hybrid between scout and analyst. And so some members of our R&D team are supporting that group quite heavily. And so they are in contact with our major league coaches every single day. For me, I probably end up meeting with a coach or our advanced scouts, at least a couple times during each homestand, something is happening. And then on the minor league side, we have a couple analysts who are fully dedicated to helping out our minor league coaches and making sure they have the information they need, looking for changes in players, often using True Media to identify some of those changes or answer questions those coaches may have. So we've moved to a system where our analysts are, I would say, lightly specialized. They aren't entirely 100% dedicated to one area, but certainly have kind of their core areas of responsibility. And so working with the coaching staff, either major league staff or minor league staff, tends to be core areas of responsibility for different analysts.
One guy might tend to focus on, we'll just say, the hitting side more. One might focus on pitching or fielding or something along those lines, that kind of specialization a little bit.
So, we have that specialization somewhat when working with coaches, but then we also have some specialization in terms of, analysts who are working on the amateur draft or working on building our pro projection system. I think this is common throughout baseball as research groups have grown. There was a time where basically, I think everybody's jobs were really determined by the calendar. If it was a couple months before the amateur draft, that's what the analyst was working on. If it was right before spring training, they were probably working on tools for the major league staff. We've now moved to a system where we have enough person power to have people sort of dedicated to some of these tasks most of the year. And we still have some analysts that float in between as necessary.
You mentioned the calendar kind of dictates what you do. What does the off season look like for your department? Those, 3 to 4 months between the end of the regular season, or of course you hope playoffs, and kind of when spring training really gets going in February.
Yeah. So hopefully the off season will be very short for us. But one of the things that's been surprising to me I've had two off seasons so far with the Twins, and I think I actually have felt much busier during the off season than during the season. That's typically a time when we've done a lot of hiring. Our group has grown a fair amount, and we rely a lot on our intern and fellowship program. And so this year we have, I think, from the analyst side, we've got 4 interns and fellows. And so we identified that group during the off season last year and interviewed a whole lot of people, had a pretty in-depth process there. And coordinating that is a pretty monumental task that a lot of our full-time group helps out with. So that, I'd say, the off season is filled with a whole lot of hiring. And I think that probably that may be somewhat atypical in that the last 2 years we've been a little busier hiring than maybe we anticipate being in the, say, next 2 years. And then also the off season includes arbitration, which is really a concerted effort for a few weeks. There's some preparation going into some meetings in the fall where we talk with Major League Baseball about our plan for arbitration. So we do a lot of preparation for those meetings. And then early January, basically right after getting back from the Christmas and New Year's break, we negotiate those deals. And it tends to be really a flurry of activity towards the end, but a fair amount of preparation put in at the beginning. And then last offseason was a little busier than usual, hiring analysts. We were also hiring hiring our major league coaching staff. After making a managerial change, first we hired the manager and then filled out the rest of the staff with a combination of people from outside the organization and people from inside the organization as well.
We're talking with Daniel Adler, Twins Director of Baseball Operations, here on the Expected Value podcast. I want to ask kind of about that hiring process, not so much the choosing the manager, but your chief baseball officer said last year the new manager would need to embrace advanced numbers and analytics. Not to say that Paul Molitor didn't before that, but that's just something that's basically a job requirement now. So from your perspective, what's the onboarding process like as you begin working with a new coaching staff? Or maybe what do you do to ensure that everyone's on the same page from a team perspective as far as analytics go?
Good question. I think for Rocco, especially coming from Tampa, where they were really one of the pioneers in this area in terms of using stats in the front office to make decisions and also with the coaching staff. He, by virtue of his experience in Tampa, spending some time in the front office and then also a fair amount of time on their coaching staff, he really probably knew a lot more about different tools that could be helpful than maybe even some of our analysts, because they've been doing some really great stuff there. So he had some ideas about what he wanted to rely on. And then we communicated that with our analysts and set them to work some of the models we already had in place, and then some of the models we had to build fresh. But we were fortunate. This was actually our second year in a row having somebody who had spent some time in the Tampa organization. Our bench coach, Derek Shelton, had joined the year before. And so it was helpful. He was a longtime hitting coach with the Rays and then spent a year with the Blue Jays. But he had a lot of ideas as from the perspective of a hitting coach of what types of stats he liked to look at and how those could be effective, how we could prepare reports. As you can imagine, and you've seen some of this firsthand, a lot of our reports are coming from true media. And I think the coaches who've had a chance to use the tools are usually pretty impressed with what they can do self-service wise. And then the things they can't, usually we can build some pretty slick reports that update automatically for them as well.
So you mentioned the hitting thing. I have to at least ask about the Twins' success this season, particularly with the home run. As we're recording this, Minnesota's a couple games clear of the Indians in the AL Central. You're leading the majors in home runs. You're on pace to destroy the Major League single season record. I saw a quote from you that you said the uppercut swing is like the three-point shot in the NBA, end quote. And I think we've seen a similar revolution kind of in the two sports recently. Without giving away, you know, state secrets or anything, what can you tell us about Minnesota's kind of home run explosion this season?
I think we've hit a lot more home runs than any projection system we've put together would have predicted. I think we've been fortunate to have really strong seasons from a number of guys. Some were in the organization before, and some were not. I think during the offseason, we made a somewhat conscious decision to sign players with a lot of power. We didn't expect, you know, this kind of result, but we did decide to prioritize power over maybe on base a little bit. And, you know, there certainly have been some games where it feels like we're a little bit feast or famine, and we have quite the number of contact hitters who can move the guys over. But again, that was a decision we made that, you know, overall, I think has led to some really strong offensive results for us.
Looking over at the defensive side, Twins have shifted 37% of the time this year, fourth most in the majors, according to MLB's tracking. So you've obviously had some success convincing coaches, players of the value of shifting. What is the process like just communicating the shift ideas to coaches and players? Because we're all familiar with, you know, the stereotype of players and coaches, which I think we know is changing. What is that like to communicate these ideas to coaches and players who at the very least needed explained or some convincing before they're going to kind of execute the concepts?
Most of that responsibility falls on our advanced analysts. I will check in with coaches and kind of ask them if they have questions. Occasionally I'll talk to players a little bit, but I really leave things in the hands of the coaches. We don't really view it as an analyst job to educate players directly for the most part. But I think we were, again, kind of fortunate that Rocco and Derek Shelton, both coming from one of the early organizations to really take advantage of shifting, they felt pretty comfortable with it. They feel good having those conversations with our pitchers after the ball sneaks through the gap where the third baseman, quote, should have been. So I think we've been able to manage that well. But hey, it's loss aversion is a very real thing. And every time the ball gets through the hole, I'll admit that I get a sinking feeling in my stomach. Oh man, we could have had an out otherwise. And also thinking there's certainly some pitchers who might be pretty disappointed, but I think we've done a good job in the major leagues communicating that. And then probably even more important, all through the minor leagues, getting players comfortable with the shift, getting fielders comfortable fielding in those positions, which can be a little bit awkward at times, particularly in situations where you're trying to turn a double play or something like that. And then also getting pitchers comfortable with the idea that we are trying to help them. This is not some evil plot to hurt their stats, but it is going to look a little bit different.
I read an article on The Athletic from last year, and you talked about how the Astros got reliever Ryan Pressly from the Twins, and like they do with seemingly everyone, Astros got him to throw his curveball more. He had great success. What do you learn from an experience like that?
Yeah, that was a tough learning experience for us. Pressly had a very solid season with us, and then he went to the Astros and became otherworldly and one of the top few relievers in baseball. I think the effectiveness of his secondary pitches, that was not a huge surprise to us. I think we had not been, as a coaching staff and probably as an analytical staff, I think we had not been creative enough to get through him to throw those pitches more frequently. And that was a big learning experience for us. And I think that it's hard. I think the Astros are really fortunate in some ways. It's a little bit of a positive feedback loop. Once you've built up the credibility that Brent Strom, their pitching coach, has, and their whole analytical group, I think it's probably they've earned that reputation, and they definitely deserve it. But I think when they ask guys to make changes, my guess is it's probably maybe a little more straightforward, and there's a little more trust. And so we're still in that phase where we need to earn the trust of our players. And I think we've had some notable successes in both minor league and major league this year that hopefully will help as we attempt to find guys in other organizations who we think maybe aren't relying on their best pitches, whether that's pitch type or if they can be throwing in a different part of the zone. They're difficult conversations, and hopefully we can earn the trust of pitchers, but we are, I feel that we've made some really positive steps in terms of our pitching analysts, to our pitching coordinators, to our pitching coaches in the minor leagues, and our pitching coaches in the major leagues. And I think we've started to see some positive results. But yeah, that was a tough, very tough lesson for us, but ultimately one that I think has made us a lot better as an organization, despite the fact that we certainly could use a reliever of Ryan Pressly's caliber.
Right. I want to go back to something you said a few minutes ago about you're taking Spanish lessons, and my cursory research told me that your Spanish was decent, and you talked about how it was different than kind of what players tend to use from different places. What sort of differences, if any, have you seen in how different baseball cultures embrace or access the analytics?
Good question. And I'll admit that I haven't had deep analytical discussions with a ton of players, whether native English speakers or native Spanish speakers. I think, one of the changes that we have as an organization have tried to be really sensitive to is making sure we have coaches at each level who speak Spanish, whether native or, fluent, as a second language, and can really explain things to guys, because I think there are situations where there are players who are very intelligent, very capable, but maybe their English is just not quite as strong, and they find themselves in a spot where they're nodding along, pretending to understand what a coach is saying, and ultimately maybe not fully absorbing it. And I think that's, for us as an organization, that's a big challenge to make sure we're communicating with each player, whether we had a player who we just recently traded who was Taiwanese and he had his translator with him all the time. In some ways, it was pretty obvious with him, his English was improving, not terribly strong, but always had a translator. So people knew that. Whereas I think there could be a player from the Dominican who knows enough English to say some of the right things, but actually isn't following stuff as much. And that's on us as an organization to make sure he understands what's going on and, so he can perform his absolute best. So I've sort of dodged the question because I don't totally have a sense for kind of different cultures, how they're embracing it. I think one thing that I can say a little bit is I think the younger players these days, guys who we just selected in the draft recently, have grown up with this stuff, whether it's something like Blast Motion or Rapsodo or TrackMan. They've been using this stuff for a couple of years and it's been part of their baseball lives for a pretty significant chunk of their career. Whereas guys who are more advanced in their career may just not be familiar with it. So we have very different challenges. I think the age differences are quite significant as well. And obviously as time goes on, we'll have some of those younger players matriculating up through the minors and into the majors. And I think that will certainly make life for analysts very different. There's probably new different challenges, but I think it's more and more common. Some of the guys we drafted this year probably have a much better idea of their Rapsodo or TrackMan stats than many analysts would have, just a couple of years ago.
That's good. And I like how you're saying the team takes that responsibility to communicate these things to them, whether it's through language differences or cultures or whatever. I want to shift gears a little bit. We're talking with Daniel Adler, Minnesota Twins Director of Baseball Operations, our guest here on Expected Value, and look a little bit at kind of how you got here, because I think you have one of the more interesting career paths for someone in a baseball front office. You worked for the Jaguars, the Browns, even I believe as a driver for the Patriots before this. And we could spend a whole podcast, I think, talking about differences in baseball and football analytics. I think the consensus would be that the NFL is, a decade, two decades behind MLB, generally speaking, from an analytics standpoint. If you had to pick out just a couple key things, what would be some of the differences you've seen in how baseball and NFL teams approach analytics as a concept and integrate them with coaching staffs?
I think probably two decades behind is probably a little harsh to football, because I think the NFL teams will probably close that gap very quickly when they so desire. And I think the next gen stat data, RFID chips in the shoulder pads and getting player tracking data is going to change things in the NFL. And I really wouldn't be surprised if in a few years NFL teams have developed their analytics groups to a level similar to where baseball is. But in terms of the differences, I think it's probably a little bit of a case of default in that, in at least in my experience with the Twins, I think a lot of the time our analytical data is sort of the starting point for our decision-making process, whether if it's setting a lineup or signing a free agent or making a trade, we have some model projecting things. And we will certainly adjust off of that model based on factors that we don't think are accurately captured by the model, but usually that model kind of sets the starting point. In the NFL, I think in my experience, the starting point for most decisions was kind of a more traditional type of analysis, more traditional scouting, more traditional coaching analysis, and then perhaps you could use analytical information to adjust that decision one way or another. But I think the voice of models and data is probably a lot stronger in baseball. And I think for the moment, I would say justifiably so, because the data we have in baseball is just much richer. There's many more games. We have ball tracking data for quite a number of years now. We have player tracking data for not quite as many years. And the game itself is probably a little bit more straightforward to quantify. We don't have every answer, but I think we have probably a few more answers than they do in football. My guess is football will make some pretty major steps forward, with the release of player tracking data to every single team.
Right. Going back kind of even before your NFL time, before your MLB time, before that, you were an economics major at Harvard. I think most baseball fans are familiar with the increase in, educated, economically minded people in baseball front offices. For you specifically, how did that economics education, kind of the nuts and bolts of that degree, help you as you got into the sports world?
So I think I went to college in a time before, I think, the rise of whether you call it data science or analytics was quite as ubiquitous. And so for me, economics ultimately comes down to allocating scarce resources and how do you make the best possible decisions with whatever resources you have. And so I think it's pretty generalizable to almost any problem you would encounter in sports or really anywhere else in life. NFL, you know, it's very obvious you have the salary cap, and how you allocate that it will ultimately determine how successful your team is. But also you have a certain number of snaps and how you decide, you know, you'll hear coaches talking about they run a certain play to set up another play. You can do a somewhat economic style cost benefit analysis to decide whether is it worth burning a play that you don't think is going to be that good that makes this other play some amount more successful. So I think viewing things through that lens has been really valuable for me in my career. And then the other piece that I got very interested in college was the intersection of economics and psychology and what biases can get in the way of maybe making the best possible decisions. And I certainly have many biases and make many poor decisions, but I really enjoy thinking about how can I maybe iron out some of those biases? How can I use data to perhaps make better decisions? And all of those things are pretty applicable to baseball, football, any sport, and really any business.
You talked earlier how you're involved in the hiring process for your department and things like that. So I'm sure you, like a lot of us in the industry, often get asked, how do I get a job with the baseball team, or how do I break into the sports industry, or something like that. What are kind of some of the key skills or experiences that you're looking for when you're trying to figure out who you're going to hire?
So there's a real opportunity now. Just the research on the public research available is quite very high quality. And admittedly, not all of the data we have access to internally is available publicly. But we're always impressed when we see somebody take a data set that's been available to many people and ask a novel question and analyze the data in a unique way and come up with some interesting insights. So certainly that's one potential way in, is, producing really good public research. The other thing for us is our application process for analysts is that we give people a data set, ask them a question, and basically have them perform some type of analysis and write it up, talk about their findings, and then we grade those blind. We have a couple people grade each one. We grade them blind, and then we choose the best people to advance to sort of some of the final stages, which are more based on fit and communication. But really, the heart of our process is if you do a really great job analyzing the data set that we give, you're going to end up with a position here. And so we have a wide range of people. We've had some people who are just finishing undergrad who've done really well, in the top few entries of over 100. We've also had some people who are who have completed PhD programs who have done really well. So that is our process for the moment, but we're continually evolving that process and trying to find new sources of talent. One thing we think about a lot is how we can attract people who are maybe didn't grow up with the MLB bed sheets, people who are just absolutely obsessed with baseball. We want people to be interested in the job and interested in tackling these problems, but looking for a diversity of thought. Maybe it's somebody who comes from a different field of study, and they might have some really new ideas to add, rather than somebody who spent their entire life reading Fangraphs, Hardball Times, Baseball Prospectus. Those people are absolutely fantastic as well, but sometimes getting somebody from a very different field can be helpful as well.
Mm-hmm. We're talking with Daniel Adler, Minnesota Twins Director of Baseball Operations, here on Expected Value. Daniel, I want to finish up with just kind of some rapid fire questions. First thing that comes to your mind, or quick response, things along those lines. Did you have a moment when you're growing up when you realized, look, I'm not going to be a professional athlete anymore, I got to figure something else out?
I think probably somewhere around middle school it became it was probably obvious long before, but middle school was where my athletic prowess peaked or probably somewhere before when I was no longer even the best player on my middle school team. So I think I figured it out then, or maybe even well before.
For any reason at all, what is your favorite statistic? This could be baseball, it could be any sport. Favorite statistic that for any reason at all?
I think win probability added is a really fun one. And I guess there are versions in both baseball and football. But I think it's fun. It tells a story about what that guy has done in a specific game. And I think that it's a lot of fun to look at. It's probably, obviously, anybody who studies it knows it's not the most predictive. We probably wouldn't make a free agent signing based purely on a player's win probability added, but just as a descriptive what happened, I think it's can tell a really good story. And I think it's also really fun to look at in the NFL when there's a really big play. How much did this help the guy's team?
Right, for sure. What is your favorite number and why?
Ooh, I'll say 3 because that my birthday is on the 3rd of the month, and that's the number I used to wear when I played baseball. I guess I was also pretty chubby, and so it's sort of in honor of as well.
You have a favorite athlete that you had growing up, any sport?
Favorite athlete, this one, it doesn't hold up quite as well, because I think his off-field history was not sterling, but Albert Bell was growing up in Cleveland as an Indians fan. Albert Bell was a real favorite of mine.
You have a best or favorite game that you've gotten to see in person?
Probably probably the most fun game I've watched as a fan was the 2002 Fiesta Bowl with Ohio State and Miami. It was really special. Went out there with my dad, brother, grandfather, some uncles and cousins. Being from Ohio, that we didn't have none of the Cleveland teams won until the Cavaliers in 2016, and we adopted Ohio State. I have some extended family members who attended there, so we sort of jumped on that bandwagon and have been on it for a long time. But going out there, it was a pretty amazing game. That Miami team was just absolutely stacked in terms of NFL talent. Ohio State was as well. Miami, I think, hadn't lost in about more than 2 years. Ohio State was a huge underdog and pulled off the championship there. And that was a pretty amazing experience.
And that was the game with the delayed pass interference call toward the end, right?
I was not going to bring up that a call people might deem questionable was quite important. Yeah, I believe that was the first overtime. So it was a 2 overtime game. In the first overtime, Ohio State needed to score a touchdown to match Miami, who had already scored a touchdown. And they threw a relatively late pass interference that gave Ohio State new life. And then they punched it in just after that, and then won on the in the subsequent overtime.
Yeah, my dad is originally from Miami and a big Hurricanes fan, so I'm kind of obligated to at least just throw that out there, make sure everyone's aware.
That game was notable for a number of reasons. The other big one that people probably remember was Willis McGahee suffering one of the more knee injuries, but he actually ended up coming back. I think it took a full year of recovery. He was drafted in the NFL, very different era in the NFL, that somebody would take a running back in the first round who you knew was not going to play for an entire year, and it was unclear whether he would be back ever. I think anyway, the running back position probably somewhat as a result of analysis has been devalued, as people have come to realize that it's maybe a position that is maybe a little easier to replace, and the career mm-hmm. length is just extremely extremely short.
All right, last question, wrap things up. Have you had a professional kind of how did I get here moment, whether, you know, something that made you shake your head in disbelief at where you were or something along those lines?
It happens a lot, and I try to maintain that sense of gratitude, because there are so many moments where I look around, and even my absolute worst day or project that's really frustrating, I think back to when I was in consulting. If somebody said, hey, you've got to do this really brutal data cleaning task, and at the end you're going to present to an NFL GM, I would have said, oh my gosh, this is unbelievable. Like, please sign me up for this job. So I think a few that come to mind. So when I was with the Jags, I was in the coaching booth during games, giving a little bit of advice on timeouts and timing situations, and occasionally some challenges. But there was one time where I made a pretty bad mistake in terms of stammering or not giving very good information, and I was promptly told by the head coach that I had made a mistake, and maybe not the nicest way ever. And it was quite a blow, and I felt really terrible. But then also stepped back, and I was thinking, "Holy crap! I'm getting yelled at by an NFL head coach during the game. Like, yes, this is not great, and I need to tighten this up and not make this mistake. But this is pretty amazing. Kind of a surreal experience. So that's one from football and baseball. I think I was really fortunate just a couple months after I started with the team here in Minnesota in 2017. I was lucky enough to be on the road with the team when we were in Cleveland and clinched the wild card game. And I had done almost nothing to earn that celebration because I had just joined the team. But it was pretty crazy to be in the locker room when people are pouring beer on each other. And I remember going up to Bartolo Colon, who was on our team. And that was a pretty surreal experience because I'd grown up watching him in his slightly slimmer and earlier days. And to be in Cleveland in the stadium where I had watched a lot of games, celebrating, celebrating the team that I now work for, making the playoffs, and exchanging a few words with Bartolo Colon was a pretty unbelievable experience as well.
Bartolo Colon's a good story to end with. Daniel Adler, Twins Director of Baseball Operations, thank you for joining us here on Expected Value.
Thanks a lot, Paul.
Back in the True Media Network studios, I'm Paul Carr, joined by Albert Larcata for some interview reaction. Albert is True Media's Senior Director of Business Development and Data Science. Albert, you've known Daniel going back to his Jaguars days. What was your top takeaway from what he had to say?
Yeah, I have known Daniel for a long time. Great guy. Lots of interesting tidbits in there. I think the one that stood out to me was early on he mentioned Rocco, the coach, coming over from Tampa, having some knowledge of the analytical side of things that the Rays do. They're sort of world-class R&D group that's well known. It's an interesting macro topic. At a high level, MLB is fortunate to have that kind of cross-pollination go on where you have, you know, smart people who end up working for a number of different teams over the course of their careers. You get to share ideas more. You get just the whole industry becomes a bit more enlightened faster than in other industries that are just getting started. However, I think in other sports like football and soccer, that's going to start to happen more. These initial hires that are coming on as more junior analysts are going to, you know, become senior analysts and then move on to other teams and other parts of the business even. And then people will backfill them and that whole process will kind of start all over again. So it's just interesting to hear that that's reached all the way up to the coaching ranks in MLB and it's just getting started in other sports.
And I think that ties into one thing I like that he said, how he encapsulated the difference between baseball and football analytics. I mean, we know the two sports are in different places analytically. Baseball's, you know, some number of years ahead. And a lot of that's because of the numbers that have mattered historically, because of data availability. I thought he phrased it well when he said that baseball analysis often starts with the numbers and then the scouting and such is layered on after that. Well, in football analysis usually starts on the coaching and scouting side with the numbers then built in after that. I mean, none of that's breaking news, of course. I thought he summed it up succinctly quite nicely, though. And a lot of the reason for that is what you're saying, because of how ideas are spreading throughout baseball.
Right, right. Yeah. Some of that's probably not even new in baseball, right? Baseball plays so many games. So pretty much every day for 6 months straight, it's really hard to, you know, dig into video like NFL coaches are able to do, having 7 days to prepare for their next opponent. Even in soccer, you usually have a week or so to prepare. So, yeah, I would imagine that's not new in baseball. The idea of using aggregated numbers, high level, you know, graphics and more, objective analysis. As opposed to digging deep into the video like they do in other sports. They just have more time. So you can uncover a lot of stuff by watching video, but not if you only have a very finite amount of time to do it.
Yeah, football, you can sometimes take whatever, half a day to maybe watch video with the goal of doing something. You could get off an analytics platform like ours in a couple minutes. You might want to take that time to pull something from the video you can't get from the numbers. The time thing's a good point, because you're not turning around and playing another game 12 to 20 hours later like you are in baseball.
Right, right, exactly. And I think in other sports, it'll become more like baseball, where I don't know if it starts with data per se, but there's almost maybe three levels. There's data will help you get into the right video to watch. You watch the video, and then you come back and help have the data help support the video. I'm not sure that first step is actually there with a lot of NFL and soccer clubs all over the world quite yet, but that would make sense to be the next step in those sports.
All right. Thanks, Albert. That will just about wrap things up for this debut episode of Expected Value. Thanks again to the Minnesota Twins' Daniel Adler for being our first guest. Some housekeeping items to take care of on the way out the door. Over the next couple weeks, we'll talk to Michael Lopez, the NFL's Director of Analytics, and Lucy Rushton, Atlanta United's Head of Technical Recruitment and Analysis. If you have guest suggestions or any feedback, please email us, expectedvalue@truemedianetworks.com. That's TRUmedianetworks.com. Or reach out on Twitter, publicly DM either @TrueMediaSports or me @PaulCarr. As we get this podcast going, we'd love it if you'd spread the word however possible, social media, digitally, talk to somebody. And of course, we'd appreciate it if you would subscribe, rate, and review the show wherever you get your podcasts. On behalf of Albert Larcata and everyone at True Media Networks, I'm Paul Carr. Thanks for listening to the first episode of Expected Value.